Okay, welcome back. So this is Revit 2022 user interface. When we first launch Revit for the first time, we'll see a bunch of thumbnails for systems projects, architectural projects, and structural projects. So for the architect, you're provided with a sample architectural project to take a look at, a sample structural project for the structural engineer, and a sample system project for the MAP engineer. Below that, we have a bunch of sample Revit families or components. We call them families because they are related to each other. This could be furniture, casework, walls, doors, whatever. So the sample models allow you to start with the existing one or open in one that you have worked on in the past. So over here on the left-hand side, we have the open command, the new command, so you can open existing models or start with a new model, open existing family or component to edit or work on a new one. You also have some recent files here at the bottom, including Autodesk docs, what's new, the online help menu and the community forum and customer support. Over here on the top left, we have the, of course, this X will close the project, the Revit software altogether. We can minimize or maximize the window. It's better to work with a maximized window like that. The question mark allows us to access the help menu, which is the F1 key as well, or what's new, essential skills video, Revit community online resources, and about Revit 2022. So if you can see here, if I click on about Revit 22, I'll be able to see which Revit version and which build I'm working on right now. I have 2022.1, which includes the latest service pack from Autodesk. If I click on this button, I can manage my license that I have, whether it's a student license or commercial license. The Revit help menu allows me to access the online help, which give me access to all the different articles, but what's new with Revit. This release notes, get started with Revit, and other topics. I can also search for a topic by name, such as doors. This will allow me to look at all the topics that have the doors keyword in them, such as placing a door. If I click on that, I can read about it or I can view a video. All right, let's switch back to Revit now. We can start a new project using the new model command. I'm prompted at this point to access a Revit template such as architectural, structural, MEP, construction. So I'm gonna go with the Imperial Architectural Template. I'll start a project with that. At the beginning of when you open Revit, you're gonna see the properties dialog box over on the left-hand side. So the first thing that I like to do is to grab that properties dialog box and move it all the way to the right-hand side and dock it on the right. If you can't dock yours, it's because your windows is minimized. You have to maximize your window first. This is gives you easy access to the view properties and element properties as a long list like that. On the left-hand side, we have a project browser, which gives us easy access to all our views, legends, schedules, sheets, families, groups, and links. So with views, examples are floor plans, elevation sections, ceiling plans. And then we don't have any legends in here, but this is where the legends will be found, such as wall tap legends, light fixture legends, our schedules, door schedules, room schedules, sheets. We place our views on sheets in order to print them to scale. Then I'm going to minimize the views folder and open the families folder. Here we have all our components or families, such as doors and windows and furniture and casework. We open the folder for doors, which is the Revit category. And under that, we see a single flush and the type of door. So doors is referred to as the doors Revit category name. Single flush is the family name. And 36x84 would be the type name. As you can see here, as I'm selecting this, it's showing up in the properties and showing me the properties of that door, okay? Such as the thickness, the height, the sill height, and what have you. I'm going to minimize that and talk about a few other things. Groups in Revit are like AutoCAD blocks. You can have 2D detail groups or 3D model groups. And links are XRefs or reference files that are linked into Revit. You can link in Revit files into Revit files or other CAD files as well. That's the project browser. Now, what happens if we accidentally delete or remove this from the view by hitting the X button here? We can always access that in the view menu. You can go to the view menu over here, user interface, and turn on the project browser by selecting the box for that. So that's same thing goes for the properties. Over here, we have the ribbon menu, which is the standard Microsoft ribbon menu. It's got the architectural tools such as walls, doors, windows, structural tools such as beams and columns and bracing and foundations and rebars. We have the steel menu, the precast menu, the systems menu here, such as ducts, pipes, cable trays. So you can, you don't have to see those all the time. You can turn them off in the options, the Revit options. They have the insert menu. That's common to all disciplines. In the insert menu, you can link Revit files into Revit files. You can link IFC files, which stands for Industry Foundation Classes. You can link in CAD files such as AutoCAD and SketchUp. You can link topography. You can link in DWF files. Incidentally, when you hover over a command, Revit, if you have Adobe Flash installed on your computer, it will show you a preview what that command does. If you hit the F1 key, it will take you to that help menu that talks about that particular topic. DWF markups are a digital web format that allows you to do markups and save them digitally in Revit as an alternate to PDFs. You can do decals, you can place decals such as the stuff you see, will allow you to create photos and bring them into Revit and do renderings for artwork or TV screens. You can bring in point clouds, which are laser scans of existing buildings and snap to the points to create accurate geometry. The coordination model allows you to link in Navisworks files into Revit. One of the latest features of Revit 2022 and probably the past couple of years is to link in PDF files or import PDF files and snap to the lines to turn them to convert a floor plan from PDF into Revit. That's pretty powerful because a lot of the drawings out there are in PDF or AutoCAD format. You can link in or import an image. You can manage your links. You can also import a CAD file as opposed to linking the CAD file. But preferably, you want to link it. You don't want to import it unless it's a typical detail. And this is where you can load a family. So loading a family from the Revit content library, which you should have installed by now. If you don't have this installed, you should look under your installed applications on your Autodesk account to install either the Imperial or the Metric library. Over here, we can see all that listed in alphabetical order all the way from annotations down to doors and all the way down to windows. So for example, if I'm looking for a specific door type that I want to load in the project, I can open the doors folder, so I double click on it, and I can load in a specific type of door, such as a double glass door, for example. Now, if you didn't remember, we were looking at the project browser over here. You look at a single flush door, and a single flush door was the only type of door that's in the project. When I click open, Revit will allow me to select what type of door I want to load and the size. So for example, I'm gonna go with this one, 72 by 84, or I can select multiple types. So when we load that door in, where does it go? It goes back to the browser and in the doors folder. And you will notice that in addition to the single flush door, we have a new type of door called door double glass. We have loaded three types. So So again, Doors is the Revit category name, Door Double Glass is the family name, and 72 by 84 is the type name. Okay, let's take a look at the elements classifications in Revit. So I've been talking about categories, and this illustrates very well how elements are classified inside of Revit. So we have nine classes of elements from left to right. These are system families, component families, in-place families, datum families, annotation families, detail items, title blocks, profile families, and views. On the left-hand side, we have system families are essentially online building, on-site building construction assemblies that are built on the job site, such as walls, floors, roofs, ceiling, stairs, and ramps. And that's it basically for that. The only thing you can add to that would be like topo. Component families are parts and assemblies typically delivered to the construction site, and they are assembled on site, such as doors, windows, casework, furniture. So it is not practical to create a door from scratch on site, but rather you wanted to have it delivered, made in the shop and delivered. So most of the Revit components are component families. They typically are hosted by some other elements, such as the level or the walls or floors. The third type of element classification are the in-place families. These are custom, unique, and project-specific, such as in-place mass and in-place component. You will come back to that later in future videos. Annotation families consists of 2D elements such as datum elements, annotation families, detail items, and title blocks. Datum elements are non-building XYZ references to establish model framework, such as levels, structural grids, and reference planes. In the future, we will learn about reference lines, reference points, and adaptive points. But levels essentially are finished floor elevations, and structural grids that will replace our structural columns. And then the reference planes are references, but not necessarily levels or grids. When we annotate our wall sections and details, we add these 2D elements such as dimensions, keynotes, tags, and symbols and text to our drawings in order to make them more readable by the contractor. Detail items composed of 2D families. And they are classified in Revit based on the 48 division CSI format. So CSI stands for Construction Specifications Institute, and this is what is referred to as the project manual or specification manual. So division one is a general, division two could be like, you know, metals, masonry, you know, finishes, wood, concrete, etc. So these would be typical for like footing channels and anchor bolts and profiles of brick and CMU. Title block families are very common. We typically use standard sheets such as 30 by 42, 22 by 34, 11 by 17, or 8.5 by 11. And we place views on sheets. So you'd find those in the sheets. And these are smart components that contain things such as date stamp, shared parameters, revision schedules, and other elements as well. Profile families are families that are referred to as sweeps and reveals. And they are 2D in nature, but then they are embedded inside a 3D element. This would be something like finished carpentry, crown molding, slab edge details, metal deck details, and other wall profiles, such as chair rails and wall bases. Views are the views that host our drawings, and these are utilized for modeling, scheduling, drafting, analysis, and visualization. So obviously in Revit, we can delete a floor plan and recreate a floor plan without having to worry about that we lost anything other than our annotations, dimensions, and notes. That's because the database of Revit contains all the information. The views themselves don't actually contain the information. It's all stored in one database. So that's the quick overview of the model elements, annotation elements, and how they are classified into 9 classes of elements. So in the case of a door, for example, you know, you can say that a door classification is component family. Okay, it's 3D in nature. It's model. It's a model element, 3D, not 2D. It's a component family as a classification. The doors is the category. When we switch back to Revit, we look at the doors folder here. This is the category name. This is the family name, and this is the type name. Moving on with the Revit user interface. We have our modeling area here. We have there's 4 elevation tags that are located over here. Let's zoom in on one specific one here. This is our elevation tag that is composed of a square portion and a triangular portion. The square portion, if the box is checked, it means that Revit will add an extra elevation over here. If the box is unchecked, Revit will delete that elevation. So it's important that this elevation does exist here. The triangle portion of that elevation tag, when you click on it, a blue line shows up. This blue line is actually the cut line of that elevation. So elevations, sections, and floor plans are all cut symbols for the model to slice and dice that model. For example, when we look at when we click an empty space, we can see here that the floor plan properties in the view range are show us that the view range cut plane is set to 4 feet above the floor, which means that it's above a windowsill. So if we click on the show button over here, we'll see a preview of the primary range and how that works, right? So the cut plane is where the cut is happening. But the windowsill, it has a top and the bottom range, and it has a view depth. So if you want to see something below the floor, you'd have to increase your view depth to the level below or the unlimited, just in case you had like framing or something like that. Also, if you had like a clear story windows, you have to increase the top and the cut plane to change to in order to see those as well. All righty. Down here, we have our view controls. The view controls currently set to 1/8 inch scale. I can change that to 1/4 inch. And you can see that the elevation tags have scaled down. So dimensions, notes, and symbols will also do the same thing. I'll change it back to 1/8 inch, and they go back to the same size again. I'm going to use the wall command in the architectural menu to create a rectangular wall. Like so, and you will notice that Revit puts the temporary dimensions around the wall. When I hit the escape button, the dimensions go away. When I click on an element, the dimensions come back. But these dimensions are not dimensions, they're actually location dimensions, which allows me to, as I grab and move the wall around, these dimensions are updating. If I want to set this wall at a specific distance, I can set it to 16 feet, for example, and it will move the wall that's already in question. If I select the wall with the crossing window, then only the elements that are crossing this window will be selected. If I select the wall with a regular window, then the entire wall has to be inside the window for that to be selected. I'm going to change the wall type to another wall type in the Revit properties type selector. I'm going to use a different type of wall, such as brick on CMU. And you can see the wall has changed in thickness. So I'm not going to be able to see what's inside the wall unless I change the level of detail, the LOD, from coarse to medium to fine level of detail. So that's what this does. So as I change that to medium level of detail, I start to see the CMU layer, the concrete masonry unity layer, the insulation layer, the air layer, and the brick veneer on the outside. So The next button allows me to change the graphic display option from hidden line to wireframe to shaded and so on and so forth. We'll come back to that later in a moment. I can also turn on my sun studies with the sun icon. The moon button allows me to turn on my shadows on or shadows off. It's just a toggle. These two buttons are the crop buttons that allows me to, if I zoom out a little bit, I can turn on my crop region. The crop region is the view extents. So this button over here says show crop and hide crop. Okay. If I, for example, decided to drag this wall outside the crop region, you see that it will be chopped at this point. The other button with the crop allows me to hide, activate the crop region or deactivate the crop region in order to see what's outside or what's not. So that's just an activation tool. If I wanted, I can bring it back. If you can see that I'm actually flipping the wall by mistake there. Alrighty, I'll bring it back. So now it's all inside the crop region. I'm going to turn off my crop region. Next, we're going to talk about the next tool, which is the in the view controls, which is the temporary height isolate. If I select the wall and I can select the temporary height isolate, which looks like the glasses tool, I can hide it, or I can come back and reset it, right? I can also click on one more time, and this time I can hide the category. Notice that Revit will put a blue-green border around it, indicating that something is hidden in this view. Although it's hidden, it will still print, right? If I wanted to reset, then I can see it back on again. So if I wanted all the elements to be hidden, but then I want this to be permanently hidden, that means I don't want to print. Instead of resetting it, I can click on apply to hide those elements permanently. How do I get them back? The next button over, it looks like a light bulb. It's called the reveal hidden elements. If I click on it, then these elements will be back on again. So I can see them like X-ray vision. There may be other elements that are hidden in the model. I can see this is a model origin, for example. So in this case, what I can do, I can select one wall or more than one wall like that. I can right click on them and say unhide in view category. The walls will turn into gray, which means now they are visible. And I click on this bulb again to turn off this X-ray mode, if you will. What happens if I want to avoid going through all this song and dance and just hide something? I can simply select everything here and go right click, hide in view category, and then all the walls will be hidden, right? Another way to access this is to access the visibility graphics. So over here in the properties, there's a button that says visibility graphics override or VG. I can click on edit, and that will allow me to open the visibility graphics override for Revit. I can hide or show something by category. I'm gonna use the slide bar over here to browse down all the way down to the bottom, find the walls category, check the box for the walls category, hit the apply button, and as a result, the walls will be visible. So that's the better way to do it globally. The other one was more for temporary purposes. All right, so that's it for the user interface. There may be a couple of things that we haven't talked about that we'll touch on in future videos. But you know, one of the last things we're gonna talk about is called the status bar. The status bar tells you what's happening next. And click to select, tap for alternates, add controls and shift unselect. So I can click on something with the left button on the mouse, hold the control key on the keyboard and select multiple elements. If I hold the shift key, I can deselect something that I already selected. Okay, that's what this does. The other thing I can do with a tab key is I can hover over something with a mouse without clicking on it, hit the tab key once on the keyboard, and then click with the left button on the mouse. So this is, it gives me a chain of selection. It's very effective when selecting a very long chain. So tab, click, tab once, click once is a technique I'm showing you right now. Couple of things before we leave the Revit interface is the quick access toolbar and the Revit options over here under the file menu. So under the quick access toolbar, I can find, for example, in the modify menu, I can find the modify tools such as move, copy, rotate, offset, align, mirror, all those basic modify tools. I have the option of right-clicking on one of them, such as the copy command, and then with right-click with the mouse, and then click on add to the quick access toolbar. Okay, that's the Windows function. I can do that with any software. Over here, I could go to the top of the menu, and then click on the quick access toolbar, find the copy command, right? Right-click on it and remove from a quick access toolbar. If this quick access toolbar is too far on the top and you can't see it for some reason, because you have other applications over it, you can click on this button to show below the ribbon. So it switches from the top of the ribbon to the below the ribbon. That's the choice you have to make. Now bring it back to above the ribbon. One thing about the menu here, the bar that's underneath the ribbon menu is very important. It's called the options bar. When I click on the wall command in the architecture menu, I get certain wall options such as location line, offset, etc. When I go back and click on the door command, I get different options for the door, and usually it's in green color right now, right? So you also will notice that this is a context menu. So when I'm in the middle of a door command right now, and I have the place door command listed over here on the far right, and it's highlighted in green all the way around. So everything to the right of the modify menu is in green. When I hit the escape button on the keyboard, this goes away, right? Back to the, let's go to the window command. So window command in the architecture menu, same thing. Now I'm, the modify command is has a line split here, and I have a window, place window options in this green area. All this green area is dedicated for the place window options. Escape is to reset the cursor. The modify button here with the arrow also does the same thing as cancel. Let's go to the file menu and look at the Revit options. So we have file new, file open, save, save as, export, print, and close, obviously. But we also have Revit options. And Revit options allows us to change the general UI, graphics, hardware, locations, file locations, rendering, etc. So in the general tab, we can set the save reminders. Revit will not save for you, so you have to save for yourself, but it will give you reminders if you want. You can also set the username. This is when you log into Revit. This username is now locked because I'm signed in as my name for my first initial and last name. When I go to the user interface, I can turn on and turn off different menus. Remember, we talked about turning off the MEP menu or the structure menu if you're not using it. But I do recommend that you keep them on, by the way. It doesn't bother you. Over here in the ribbon tab switching behavior, I like to keep this to stay on the modify tab. So if you are following up with me on this tutorial, I would recommend that you change that in order when you hit escape on the keyboard, your menu goes back to the modify tab as opposed to goes to the previous tab. You don't want to have a different behavior. You can choose to use the hardware graphic acceleration if available. So that will give you a little bit more fidelity in your graphics. Under the graphics tab, you can choose to change the selection color and the pre-selection color. You see how I was able to move my cursor over a wall, and the wall will turn purple. So I recommend that you click on the pre-selection color and change that to a different color than the blue, because these two are blue by default. Also change the temporary dimension text appearance from 8 point to 10 point. those are the recommendations for the changes you make. Nothing else here needs to be modified. We get our file locations, tells you that the Revit templates, project templates are located in this path. Your user files are here unless you're working on a server. So you go to the server to browse the server to save your projects. Your family templates, your point clouds, and you also have the ability to go to places. You go to places over here. And in places, you have the ability to add a path for your user files. For example, if I wanted to, right now, this is where the Imperial Library path is located, right? When we did the load family, it went to this path. And I can change that path if I want to, but there's no need for that at the moment. But I can add a new location on my folder. So I can click on plus, give it a new name, such as a new folder, and then go over here and browse to the location where I want my folder to be, and that will be saved. So let's say I want to save under my computer and data, and then that's it. I want to save that under my data. Click OK to accept. And then that will be a new place for me. What that does, it allows me to, when I go to the file new or file open command, allows me to find that new folder as a shortcut in my Windows dialog box. So that's what this is. Okay, that's it for this video. See you in the next video. Thank you for your attention.